this evening's speaker. Hannah Arendt was born in Germany, where she studied philosophy with Karl Jaspers, received a PhD in 1928 from the University of Heidelberg. She's taught at the University of Chicago from the Committee for Social Thought. She's presently on the graduate faculty of philosophy, the New School for Social Research in New York. She's the author of numerous books, among them The Origins of Totalitarianism, The Human Condition, Eichmann in Jerusalem, Between Past and Future, On Revolution. She's a contributor to such intellectual journals as the New York Review of Books and the New Yorker. Her subject this evening is Lying in Politics, Reflections on the Pentagon Papers. She's consented to answer some questions afterwards. After her talk is over, I'll come back up and recognize you and repeat questions. Professor Hannah Arendt.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Good evening. Now, the Pentagon Papers, about which I'm supposed to talk tonight, is so much else in history, tell different stories and teach different lessons. I think they are still seeds to different readers. But most readers, there are not very many readers of these Pentagon Papers. Not only are there not very many among the government circles, for whom, after all, this whole study was undertaken, there are not very many readers among the laymen either. But those who did read it, they have in general agreed that the basic issue raised by the papers is deception. Because of the extravagant length to which the commitment to non-truthfulness in politics went on the highest level of government, and because of the concomitant extent to which lying was permitted to proliferate throughout the ranks of all government services, military and civilian, one is easily tempted to forget the background of past history itself, not exactly a story of immaculate virtue, against which this newest episode must be seen and judged. For secrecy, what the diplomats call discretion, as well as the arcana imperii, the mysteries of government, and deception, the deliberate falsehood and the outright lie used as legitimate means to achieve political ends, have been with us since the beginning of recorded history. Truthfulness has never been counted among the political virtues, and lies have always been regarded as justifiable truths in political dealings. The ability to lie, the deliberate denial of factual truth, and the capacity to change facts, the ability to act, are interconnected. They owe their existence to the same source, imagination. For it is by no means a matter of course that we can say the sun shines when it actually is raining, the consequence of certain brain injuries is a loss of this capacity. It rather indicates that while we are well equipped for the world, sensually as well as mentally, we are not fitted or embedded into it as one of its inalienable parts. We are free to change the world and to start something new in it. Without the mental freedom to deny or affirm existence, to say yes or no, not just to statements or proposition in order to express agreement or disagreement, but to things as they are given, beyond agreement or disagreement, to our organs of perception and cognition, no action would be possible. And action is, of course, the very stuff politics is made of. Hence, when we talk about lying, and especially about lying among acting men, let us remember that the lie did not creep into politics by some accident of human sinfulness. Moral outrage for this reason alone is not likely to make it disappear. The deliberate falsehood deals with contingent facts, that is, with matters which carry no inherent truth within themselves, no necessity to be as they are. Factual truths are never compellingly true. The historian knows how vulnerable is the whole texture of facts in which we spend our daily life. It is this fragility that makes deception so very easy up to a point, and so very tempting. It never comes into a conflict with reason, because things could indeed have been as the liar maintains that they are. Lies are often much more plausible, more appealing to reason than reality, since a liar has a great advantage of knowing beforehand what the audience wishes or expects to hear. He has prepared his story for public consumption with a careful eye of making it credible, whereas reality has a disconcerting habit of confronting us with the unexpected for which we were not prepared. Now, to the many genres of lying developed in the past, we must now add two more recent varieties. There is first the apparently innocuous one of the public relations managers in government who learned their trade from the inventiveness of Madison Avenue. Public relations is but a variety of advertising. Hence has its origin in the consumer society with its inordinate appetite for goods to be distributed through a market economy. The trouble with the mentality of the public relation man is that he deals only in opinions and goodwill. The readiness to buy, that is in intangibles whose concrete reality is at a minimum. This means that for his inventions, it may indeed look as though the sky is the limit, for he lacks the politician's power to act, to create facts, and thus that simple everyday reality which sets limits to power and brings the forces of imagination down to earth. The only limitation to what the public relations man does comes when he discovers that the same people who perhaps can be manipulated to buy a certain kind of soap cannot be manipulated, though of course it could be forced by terror, to buy opinions and political views. Hence, the psychological premise of human manipulability has become one of the chief wares that are sold on the market of common and learned opinion. But such doctrines do not change the way people form opinions or prevent them from acting according to their own lights. The only method, short of terror, to have real influence on their conduct is still the old carrot and stick approach. It is not surprising that the recent generation of intellectuals who grew up in the insane atmosphere of rampant advertising and were taught that half of politics is image making and the other half the art of making people believe in the imagery should almost automatically fall back on the older adage of carrot and stick whenever the situation becomes too serious for theory. To them, the greatest disappointment in the Vietnam adventure should have been the discovery that there are people with whom carrot and stick methods don't work either. The second variety, though less frequent in everyday life, plays a more important role in the Pentagon Papers. It also appeals to much better men, to those, for example, who are likely to be found in the higher ranks of the civilian services. They are, in Neil Sheehan's felicitous phrase, professional problem solvers. And they were drawn into government from the universities and the various think tanks, some of them equipped with game theories and systems analysis and prepared, as they thought, to solve all the problems of foreign policy. A significant number of the authors of the McNamara study belonged to this group, which consisted of 18 military officers and 18 civilians from think tanks, universities, and government services. They certainly were not a flock of dopes. A mere handful were critical of the United States commitment in Vietnam. And still, it is to them that we owe this truthful, though of course not complete story of what happened inside the machinery of government. The basic integrity of those who wrote the report is beyond doubt. They could indeed be trusted by Mr. McNamara to produce an encyclopedic and objective report and to let, as McNamara said, the chips fall where they may. But these moral qualities, which deserve admiration, clearly did not prevent some of them from participating for many years in the game of deceptions and falsehoods. Confident of place of education and accomplishment, they lied perhaps out of a mistaken patriotism. But the point is that they lied not so much for their country, certainly not for their country's survival, which was never at stake, as for its image. In spite of their undoubted intelligence, they also believe that politics is but a variety of public relations and were taken in by all the bizarre psychological premises underlying this belief. Still, they obviously were different from ordinary image makers. Their distinction lies in that they were problem solvers as well. Hence, they were not just intelligent, but prided themselves on being rational, and they were indeed to a rather frightening degree above sentimentality and in love with theory, expressed in pseudo-mathematical language which would unify the most disparate phenomena with which reality presented them. That is, they were eager to discover laws by which to explain and predict political and historical facts as though they were as necessary and thus as reliable as a physicist once believed natural phenomena to be. Reason, aversion to contingency is very strong. It was Hegel, the father of the modern grandiose concepts of history, who held that philosophical contemplation has no other intention than to eliminate the accidental. Indeed, much of the modern arsenal of political theory, the game theories and systems analysis, the scenarios written for imagined audiences, and the careful enumeration of usually three options, A, B, C, whereby A and C represent the opposite extremes, and B, the seemingly logical middle-of-the-road solution of the problem, has its source in this deep-rooted aversion. The fallacy of such thinking begins, of course, with forcing the choices into mutually exclusive dilemmas. Reality never presents us with anything so neat as premises for logical conclusions. The kind of thinking that presents both A and C as undesirable and therefore settles on B hardly serves any other purpose than to divert the mind and blunt the judgment for the multitude of real possibilities. What these problem solvers have in common with down-to-earth liars is the attempt to get rid of facts and the confidence that this could be possible because of the inherent contingency of all facts. The truth of the matter is that this can never be done by either theory or opinion manipulation, as though a fact is safely removed from the world if only enough people believe in its non-existence. It can be done only through radical destruction, as in the case of the murderer who says that Mrs. Smith has died and then goes and kills her. In the political domain, such destruction would have to be wholesale. Needless to say, there never existed on any level of government such a will to wholesale destruction. In spite of the fearful number of war crimes committed in the course of the war, but even where this will is present, as it was in the case of both Hitler and Stalin, the power to achieve it would have to amount to omnipotence in order to eliminate Trotsky's role from the history of the Russian Revolution. It is not enough to kill him and eliminate his name from all records so long as one cannot kill all his contemporaries and wield power over all countries of the earth. Now, that concealment, falsehood, and the role of the deliberate lie became the chief issues of the Pentagon Papers rather than illusion, error, miscalculation, and the like, is mainly due to the strange fact that the mistaken decisions and lying statements consistently violated the astoundingly accurate factual reports of the intelligence community, at least as quoted in the Bantam edition. The crucial point here is not merely that the policy of lying was hardly ever aimed at the enemy. This is one of the reasons why the papers don't reveal any military secrets. But chiefly, if not exclusively, that we are destined for domestic consumption, for propaganda at home, and especially for the purpose of deceiving Congress. The Tonkin incident, where the enemy knew all the facts and the Senate's Foreign Relations Committee none, is a case in point. Of even greater interest, nearly all decisions in this disastrous enterprise were made in full cognizance of the fact that they probably could not be carried out. Hence, goals had constantly to be shifted. There are first the publicly proclaimed objective, see that the people of South Vietnam are permitted to determine their future, or assisting the country to win their contest against the communist conspiracy, or the containment of China and the avoidance of the domino effect, or the protection of America's reputation as a counter-subversive guarantor. You are all familiar with this. The same flexibility marks tactical consideration. North Vietnam is being bombed in order to prevent a collapse of morale in the South, in particular the breakdown of the Saigon government. But when the first raids were scheduled to start, the government had broken down. Pandemonium reigned in Saigon. The raids had to be postponed, and a new goal, a new end for the raids had to be found. Not the objective, now the objective became to compel Hanoi to stop the Viet Cong, an aim that even the Joint Chiefs did not hope to attain. As they said, it would be idle to conclude that these efforts will have a decisive effect. Nevertheless, the raid started. From 65 on, the notion of a clear-cut victory receded into the background, and the objective became, I'm quoting, to convince the enemy that he could not win. Since the enemy remained unconvinced, the next goal appeared, to avoid a humiliating defeat. As though the hallmark of a defeat in war were mere humiliation. What the Pentagon Papers report is the haunting fear of the impact of defeat not on the welfare of the nation, but on the reputation of the United States and its president. There was finally the political aim to show the world the lengths to which the United States will go for a friend and to fulfill commitments. Obviously, I quote a great deal and cannot always indicate them. All these goals existed together, almost in a helter-skelter fashion. None was permitted to cancel its predecessors, for each addressed itself to a different audience, and for each a different scenario had to be written. McNaughton's much-quoted enumeration of United States aims in 1965, 7% to avoid humiliating defeat, 20% to keep South Vietnam from Chinese hands, and 10% to permit the people of South Vietnam to enjoy a better way of life. This is refreshing in its honesty, but was probably drawn up only in order to bring some kind of clarity into the debates on the forever troublesome question of why we were conducting a war in Vietnam, of all places. In a previous draft memorandum, McNaughton had shown, perhaps unwittingly, how little he himself, even at that early stage, believed in the attainability of any substantial objective. He writes, should South Vietnam, please, in 1964, should South Vietnam disintegrate completely beneath us, we should try to hold it together long enough to permit us to try to evacuate our forces, of course, and to convince the world to accept the uniqueness and congenital impossibility of the South Vietnam case. To convince the world, to demonstrate that the United States was a good doctor, willing to keep promises, be tough, take risks, get blooded, and hurt the enemy badly, all these are quotes. To use a tiny backward nation devoid of any strategic importance as a test case of United States' capacity to help a nation meet a communist war of liberation, to keep intact an image of omnipotence, our worldwide position of leadership, to demonstrate the will and the ability of the United States to have its way in world affairs, to show the credibility of our pledges to friends and allies. In short, as Mr. Rostow put it, to behave like the greatest power in the world for no other reason than to convince the world of this simple fact. This was the only permanent goal, which with the beginning of the Johnson administration pushed into the background all other goals and theories, the domino theory and anti-communist strategy of the initial stages of the Cold War period, as well as the counterinsurgency strategy so dear to the Kennedy administration. The ultimate aim was neither power nor profit, nor was it even influence in the world in order to serve particular tangible interests for the sake of which prestige and image of the greatest power in the world was needed and used. The goal was the image itself, as is manifest in the very language of the problem solvers, with their scenarios and audiences borrowed from the theater. For this ultimate aim, all policies became short-term, interchangeable means, until finally, when all signs pointed to defeat in the war of attrition, the goal was no longer one of avoiding humiliating defeat, but of finding ways and means to avoid admitting it and save face. Now, image making is global policy, not world conquest, but victory in the battle, as they say, to win the people's minds, is indeed something entirely new in the huge arsenal of human follies recorded in history. This was not undertaken by a third-rate nation, always apt to boast in order to compensate for the real thing, nor by one of the old colonial powers that lost their position as a result of the Second World War and might have been tempted, as the goal was, to bluff its way back to preeminence, but by the dominant power at the war's end. It may be natural for elected office holders who owe so much, or believe they owe so much, to their campaign managers to think that manipulation is a ruler of the people's minds and hence a true ruler of the world. What is surprising is the eagerness of those scores of intellectuals who offered their enthusiastic help in this imaginary enterprise, perhaps because they were fascinated by the sheer size of mental exercises it seemed to demand. No reality and no common sense could penetrate the minds who indefatigably prepared their scenarios for relevant audiences to change their states of mind. The communists, who must feel strong pressure, the South Vietnamese, whose morale must be lifted up, our allies, who must trust us as underwriters, and the United States public, which must support the risk-taking. We know today to what an extent all these audiences were misjudged, according to a very good article which I would recommend by Richard J. Barnett. The war, he says, became a disaster because the national security managers misjudged each audience. Now, the greatest, indeed the basic misjudgment was to address audiences with the means of war to decide military matters from a political and public perspective, whereby political meant the perspective of the next presidential election, in public relations, the United States world image, and to think not about the real risks, but of techniques to minimize the impact of bad outcomes. Among proposals for the latter, the creation of diversionary offensive elsewhere in the world was recommended, together with the launching of an anti-poverty program for underdeveloped areas, only in order to minimize the impact of defeat. Not for a moment did it occur to McNaughton, the author of this proposition, that his diversions, unlike the diversions of the theater, would have had grave and totally unpredictable consequences. They would have changed the very world in which the United States moved and conducted its war. It is this remoteness from reality that will haunt the reader of the Pentagon paper who has the patience to stay with them to the end. Varnet, whom I quoted before, has this to say: the bureaucratic model had completely displaced reality, the hard and stubborn facts which so many intelligence analysts were paid so much to collect were totally ignored. Now, the divergence between facts and the premises, theories, and hypotheses according to which decision were finally made is total. And the extent of our failures and disasters throughout these years can be grasped only if one has the totality of this divergence firmly in mind. The war critics have denounced all these theories because of their obvious clash with known facts, such as the non-existence of a Sino-Soviet bloc known to everybody familiar with the history of this Chinese Revolution, or the fragmented character of the communist movement since the end of the Second World War. A number of them have gone further and developed a theory of their own. America, emerging as the greatest power after the Second World War, has embarked upon a consistent imperialist policy which ultimately aims at world rule. The advantage of this theory was that it could explain the absence of national interest in the whole enterprise. The sign of imperialist aims has always been that they were neither guided nor limited by national interest and territorial boundaries. So it could hardly account for the fact that we were madly insisting, as George Ball had the courage to tell Johnson in 1965, on pouring our resources down the drain in the wrong place. For clearly, this was no case of limited means to achieve excessive ends. Was it excessive for a superpower to add one more small country to its string of client states, or to win a victory over a tiny backward nation? It was rather an unbelievable example of using excessive means to achieve minor aims in a region of marginal interest. Now, the only statements of the American government during this period that indeed told almost gospel truths were the often repeated claims, ever so much less plausible, that we were seeking no territorial gains nor any other tangible profit. This is not to say that a genuine American global policy with imperialist overtones would have been impossible after the collapse of the old colonial powers. The Pentagon Papers reveal one incident which seems to indicate how considerable the chances were for a global policy that then was gambled away for the sake of image-making and of fighting non-existent conspiracies. According to a cable from an American diplomat in Hanoi, Ho Chi Minh wrote several letters in 1945 and 1946 to Truman requesting the United States to support the idea of Annamese independence according to the Philippine example, to examine the case and to take steps necessary to maintenance of world peace, which is being endangered by French efforts to reconquer Indochina. A second and equally striking incident came only recently to our attention. Mao and Chu Enlai, it turns out, had approached President Roosevelt in January 1945, trying to avoid to establish relations with the United States in order to avoid total dependence on the Soviet Union. These letters, Ho Chi Minh never received an answer, and the Chinese approach was suppressed because it contradicts it, as Professor Whiting has said, the image of monolithic communists directed from Moscow, indeed. Although the decision makers certainly knew about the intelligence report, I think it entirely possible that they were not aware of these earlier documents, which would have given the lie to all their premises before they could grow into full-blown theory. This shed some light on one of the gravest dangers of overclassification. Not only are the people denied access to what they must know to form an opinion, but the actors themselves, who receive top clearance to learn all the relevant facts, remain blissfully unaware of them. Even now that the press has brought a certain portion of them into the public domain, it does not look as though those most in need of this information have read them or ever will. If the mysteries of government have so befogged the minds of the actors themselves that they no longer know or remember the truth behind their concealment and their lies, the whole operation of deception, no matter how well organized and how sophisticated its Madison Avenue gimmickry, will run aground or become counterproductive, that is, confuse people without convincing them. For the trouble with lying and deceiving is that their efficiency depends entirely upon a clear notion of the truth which the liar and deceiver wishes to hide. In this sense, truth, even if it does not prevail, possesses an ineradicable primacy over all falsehood. In the case of the Vietnam War, we are confronted, in addition, with a truly amazing and entirely honest ignorance of the historical pertinent background. Not only did the decision makers seem ignorant of all the well-known facts of the Chinese Revolution and the decade-old rift between Moscow and Peking, no one at the top, it has been said, knew or considered it important that the Vietnamese had been fighting foreign invaders for almost 2,000 years, and that the notion of the tiny backward nation without interest to civilized nations, unhappily often shared by the war critics, stands in flagrant contradiction to the very old and highly developed culture of the region. What Vietnam lacks is not culture, but strategic importance, a suitable terrain for modern mechanized armies, and rewarding targets for the Air Force. What caused the disastrous defeat of American policies and armed invention was indeed the willful, deliberate disregard of all facts, political, geographical, for more than 25 years. Now, if the quagmire model, which Arthur Schlesinger, as you may remember, has proposed, that is the model that the whole thing works, you do only one more step and everything will work out all right, and then it turns out one more step and one more step until you fall into the quagmire. If the quagmire model is a myth, and if no grand imperialist strategies or will to world conquest can be discovered, as I believe, let alone interest in territorial gains, desire for profit, or least of all, of course, concern about national security. If, moreover, we are not inclined to be satisfied with such general notions as Greek tragedy, or step in the back legends, always dear to generals in defeat, then the question recently raised by Daniel Ellsberg, how could they, rather than deception and lying per se, will become the basic issue of this dismal story. For the truth, after all, is that the United States was the richest country and the dominant power after the end of World War II, and that today, a mere quarter of a century later, Mr. Nixon's metaphor of the pitiful, helpless giant is an uncomfortably apt description of the mightiest country on earth, unable to defeat with 1,000-to-1 superiority and firepower a small nation in 6 years of overt warfare, unable also to take care of its domestic problems, having wasted its resources to the point where inflation and currency devaluation threaten its international trade as well as its standard of life at home, the country is in danger of losing much more than its claim to world leadership. And even if one anticipates the judgment of future historians who may see this development in the context of 20th century history, when the defeated nations in two world wars managed to come out on top in competition with the victors, chiefly, of course, because we are compelled by the victors to rid themselves of the incredible wastefulness of armaments and military expenses. It remains, even if you take all this into account, it remains hard to reconcile oneself to so much effort wasted on demonstrating the impotence of power, or rather, the impotence of bigness. So one may welcome this unexpected revival of David's triumph over Goliath on so large a scale. The first explanation, anyhow, that comes to mind to answer the question, how could they, is likely to point to the interconnectedness of deception and self-deception. In the contest between public statements, always over-optimistic, and the truthful reports of the intelligence, a community persistently bleak and ominous, the public statesmen were liable to win simply because they were public. The great advantage of publicly established and accepted proposition over whatever an individual may secretly know to be the truth is neatly illustrated by a medieval anecdote, for brevity's sake, according to which a sentry who was on duty to watch and warn the small town of the approach of the enemy, jokingly sounded a false alarm and was then the last to rush to the walls to defend the town against the imagined enemies. From this one may conclude that the more successful a liar is, the more people he has convinced, the more likely it is that he will end by believing his own lies. In the Pentagon Papers, we deal with people who did their utmost to win the minds of the people, that is to manipulate them, but since they labored in a free country where all kinds of information were available, they never really succeeded. Because of their relative high station and their position in government, they were better shielded against this public information, which also more or less told the factual truth, than those whom they tried to convince, and whom they were likely to think of in terms of mere audiences, silent majorities, etc., who were supposed to watch there the Senate's productions. The fact that the Pentagon Papers revealed hardly any spectacular news testifies to the liar's failure to create a convinced audience, which they then could join themselves. Still, the presence of what Ellsberg has called the process of internal self-deception is beyond doubt. But it is as though the normal process of self-deceiving were reversed. It was not as though deception ended with self-deception. The deceiver started with self-deception, probably because of their high station and their astounding self-assurance. They were so convinced of overwhelming success, not on the battlefield, of course, but on the grounds of public relations, also so certain of the soundness of their psychological premises about the unlimited possibilities in manipulating people, that they anticipated general belief and victory in the battle for people's minds. And since they lived anyhow in a defactualized world, they did not find it difficult to pay no more attention to the fact that their audience refused to be convinced than to other facts. In the realm of politics, where secrecy and deliberate deception have always played a significant role, self-deception is a danger par excellence. The self-deceived deceiver loses all contact, not only with his audience, but with the real world, which will catch up with him, as he can remove only his mind from it and not his body. The problem solvers who knew all the facts presented regularly to them in the reports of the intelligence community had only to rely on their techniques, that is, on the various ways of translating qualities and contents into quantities and numbers with which to calculate outcomes which then unaccountably never came true, in order to eliminate day in, day out what they knew to be real. The reason why this could work for so many years is precisely that the goals pursued by the government were almost exclusively psychological, that is, matters of the mind. Reading the memos, the options, the scenarios, the way percentages are ascribed to the potential risks and returns of contemplated actions, one sometimes has the impression that a computer rather than decision makers had been let loose in Southeast Asia. The problem solvers did not judge, they calculated. Their self-confidence did not even need self-deception to be sustained in the midst of so many misjudgments, for it relied on the evidence of mathematical, purely rational truth. Except, of course, that this truth was entirely irrelevant for the problem at hand. If, for instance, it can be calculated that the outcome of a certain action is less likely to be a general war than more likely, it does not follow that we can choose it, even if the proportion were 80 to 20, because of the enormity and incalculable quality of the risk. And the same is true when the odds, and now I'm quoting, of reform in the Saigon government versus the chance that we will wind up like the French in 1954 are 70% to 30. That's a nice outlook for a gambler, not for a statesman. And even the gambler would be better advised to take into account what gain or loss actually means for him in daily life. Loss may mean utter ruin, gain no more than some welcome but non-essential improvement of his financial affairs. Only if nothing real is at stake for the gambler, if with more or less money is not likely to make any difference in his standard of life, can he safely rely on the percentage gain? The trouble with our conduct of the war was that no such control given by reality itself ever existed in the minds of either the decision makers or the problem solvers. The reason why such excessively costly means were permitted to be used for such politically irrelevant ends must be sought not merely in the unfortunate superabundance in the country, but in its inability to understand that even great power is limited power. Behind the constantly repeated cliché of the mightiest power on earth, there lurks the dangerous myth of omnipotence. Despite of all the later calculation of costs, returns, and risks of certain acts, the calculators remain totally unaware of any absolute non-psychological limitation. And this deadly combination of the arrogance of power with the arrogance of the mind, an utterly irrational confidence in the calculability of reality, becomes the leitmotif of the decision-making processes from the beginning of the escalation in 1964. This, however, is not to say that the problem solvers' rigorous methods of defactualization are at the root of this relentless march into self-destruction. The problem solvers who lost their mind because they trusted the calculating power of their brain at the expense of the mind's capacity for experience and its ability to learn from it, they were preceded by the ideologists of the Cold War period. Anti-communism, not the old, often prejudiced hostility of America against socialism and communism, but the post-war comprehensive ideology, was originally the brainchild of ex-communists who needed a new ideology by which to explain and reliably foretell the course of history. This ideology was at the root of all theories in Washington since the end of the Second World War. I mentioned before the extent to which sheer ignorance of all pertinent facts and deliberate neglect of post-war developments became the hallmark of established doctrine within the establishment. They needed no facts, no information. They had a theory, and all data that did not fit were denied or ignored. The methods of this older generation, that is the methods of Mr. Rusk, as distinguished from those of Mr. McNamara, were less complicated, less brainy than those of the problem solvers, but not less efficacious in shielding men from the impact of reality and in ruining the mind's capacity for judgment and for learning. They prided themselves of having learned from the past, from Stalin's rule over all communist parties, hence the notion of monolithic communism, and from Hitler starting a world war after Munich, from which they concluded that every gesture of reconciliation was a second Munich. They were unable to confront reality on its own terms, because they had always some parallels in mind that helped them to understand them. When Johnson, still in his capacity as Kennedy's vice president, came home from an inspection tour in South Vietnam and happily reported that Diem was a Churchill of Asia, one would have thought that the parallelism game would die from sheer absurdity. But this was not the case. Now, can one say that the left-wing war critic thought in very different terms? The extreme fringe had the unhappy inclination of denouncing as fascist or Nazi whatever often quite rightly displeased them, and of calling every massacre a genocide, which obviously it was not. You know, I suppose that the population figure in South Vietnam has gone up during the last 10 years. So, genocide. This could only help to produce a mentality which was quite willing to condone massacre and other war crimes so long as they were not genocide. The problem solvers were remarkably free from the sins of the ideologists. They believed in methods, but not in worldviews. But though they did not believe in such generally accepted rationales for policies as a domino theory, these theories with their different methods of defactualization provided the atmosphere and the background against which the problem solvers then went to work. They had, after all, to convince the Cold Warriors, whose minds then turned out to be singularly well prepared for the abstract games they had to offer. Defactualization and problem solving were welcomed because disregard of reality was inherent in the policies and goals themselves. What did they have to know about Indochina as it really was, when it was no more than a test case or a domino or a means to contain China or to prove that we are the mightiest of the superpowers? How could they be interested in anything so real as victory when they kept the war going neither for territorial gain nor economic advantage, least of all to help a friend or keep a commitment, nor even for the reality as distinguished from the image of power? When this stage of the game was reached, the initial premise that we should never mind the region or the country itself, inherent in the domino theory, changed into a kind of never mind the enemy, and this in the midst of a war. The result was that the enemy, poor, abused, and suffering, grew stronger, while the mightiest country grew weaker with each passing year. There are historians today who maintain that Truman dropped the bomb on Hiroshima in order to scare the Russians out of Eastern Europe, with the result we know. If this is true, as it may well be, then we may trace back the earliest beginnings of this disregard for the actual consequences of action in favor of some ulterior calculated aim to the fateful war crime that ended the last World War. Now, at the beginning of this analysis, I tried to suggest that the aspects of the Pentagon paper that I have chosen, the aspects of deception, self-deception, image-making, ideologizing, and defactualization, are by no means the only features of the papers that deserve to be studied and learned from. There is, for instance, the fact that this massive and systematic effort at self-examination was commissioned by one of the chief actors, that 36 men could be found to compile the documents and write the analysis, some of whom had helped to develop or carry out the policies they were asked to evaluate. That one of the authors, when it became apparent that no one in government was willing to use or even to read the results, went to the public and leaked it to the press. And that finally the most respectable newspapers in the country dared to bring material that was stamped top secret to the widest possible attention. It has rightly been said that McNamara's decision to find out what went wrong and why may turn out to be one of the most important decisions in his 7 years at the Pentagon. It certainly restored, at least for a fleeting moment, this country's reputation in the world. What had now happened could indeed hardly have happened anywhere else. It is as though all these people involved in an unjust war and rightly compromised by it had suddenly remembered what they owed to their forefathers, decent respect for the opinions of mankind. No doubt all this can change. But one thing has become clear in the last year. The half-hearted attempts of the government to circumvent constitutional guarantees and to intimidate those who have made up their minds not to be intimidated, who would rather go to jail than see their liberties nibbled away, are not enough and probably never will be enough to destroy the Republic. There is reason to hope, as one of the country's 2.5 million veterans, whom I am quoting, that the country might regain its better side as a result of the war. I know it's nothing to bet on, he said, but neither is anything else I can think of.
Questions? Hands? Stand up.
No questions? No questions? No,
repeat the question.
Repeat the question.
The gentleman said in Nazi Germany, lying, deception worked because they worked on the hopes and fears of the people. Is this the same as in the United States?
I would not even say it's true for Nazi Germany. In Nazi Germany, the lying deceptions served a quite definite a purpose, namely to instill into the people a new kind of thinking. That is, to think along racial lines which they hadn't done before. And to convince them, for instance, of not just of the Jewish business, but that you have got to deal with people in this way, extermination, in order to improve the race. Yeah? To put it, of course, this is oversimplified. In the United States, if they would have catered to the hopes and fears of the people, then they would have given this was never the case. They would have been much closer to the people. That is, it would be much, I don't think that this has anything to do with populism, where you, so to speak, take your cue from the hopes and fears of the people and then cater to it. Yeah? Nothing of the kind. I mean, the people of America are not imperialistically, are not inclined, and they don't care about America's image in the world. I mean, the people. This did not play on this. This was an internal process in Washington, which had very little to do with the people at large. What the people wanted was the boys come home. Yeah? This, yes. And they were not even very much interested in that, because the boys were, as we all know, in the vast majority from a class which does not make its fears or hopes, has no power to make these fears or hopes felt at large. Don't forget that the exemption for the college and the university was very effective indeed, and that only certain classes in the general draft went. Very late came the lottery, you know. And this already at a time when the draft quotas went down. So nothing of that will work. You will have to look at these mentality of these people who really thought that no facts were in their way. And they did not want world conquest. I think a typical imperialist things are sea and air bases, yeah? For the foreign policy of imperialists are always demand sea bases and air bases. Now this whole business is discussed, comes up in the Pentagon Papers, as far as I can see, twice. Because the Joint Chiefs of Staff say that if they will lose, South Vietnam will not be so good for the sea and air bases of the United States. And the second time, if I remember rightly, in a memo of McNamara, in which he denies, he says, we don't need any sea or air bases, and certainly not in this part of the world. See, the whole thing has a touch, because it was precisely Vietnam and nowhere else, the whole thing has a slight touch of insanity. And this touch goes through the Pentagon Papers. You can see that everywhere. You see time and again how they sit and try to figure out why they are there, why we are there to begin with, and why we should stay there to begin with. And then, oh yes, don't you remember the domino theory? And don't you remember containment of China? Now, containment of China, this myth has now been explored by the President of the United States. It was a chief reason. Then you have this bombing of North Vietnam, all in order to lift the morale in South Vietnam. In fact, it had the most fantastic consequences as far as North Vietnam was concerned. It really glued them together as a people. You know, it lifted the morale. It lifted the morale in North Vietnam, not in South Vietnam. And all this has been foretold. You know, these are not things by hindsight. On the contrary, I was struck when I read these papers that there is not a single argument by the war critics, by the opposition, which of course was highly qualified in this country, not a single argument, a single way, not only no facts, but not a single way of reasoning that doesn't appear there too, you know. So only that it's being pushed, it comes from the intelligence community. It's being pushed aside by the decision makers. Has nothing to do with it. Don't look for parallels. Yeah, that's so. Because they think if we do it only a little bit more, then it will work, you know. And the trouble is, of course, that most people really believe in that the people can be manipulated. And you know that the social sciences have taught hardly anything else during the last 20 years. And the truth of the matter is that every single public opinion poll you know, shows how dangerous it is to believe any such things. You know, I don't know how many times they were absolutely sure already that they had manipulated the people. Turned out, no, not at all. Absolutely not. For better and worse. Don't think that I believe in the unquestioningly in the sound instincts of the people, by no means. Only I don't believe in the manipulation. People look and listen, and then they go and do something altogether different. And this has happened not only in this country, it has happened everywhere. And it just isn't true. Yeah, sure. Look, remember the anecdote I told you perhaps too shortly. Suppose you are on one of these walls to watch out for enemies, yeah? And you think how nice it would be if the whole town would run, yeah? The point is this. No, see, I said something else. I said, what is being said in public and repeated by everybody finally convinces the liar you had spread it that this must be the truth. Now, this is a very strange phenomenon, and this is by no means the first time that you can be aware of it. That is a deception and self-deception. Suppose it's very interesting, for instance, in the totalitarian governments, since people have to see day in, day out, what they know is not true, they finally believe that it is true. Because they cannot believe that something which they know only for themselves, in the privacy, you know, of their own heart, that this could be true. See, for our sense of reality depends to a large extent that we share this world with other people. If we were all alone in the world, we wouldn't believe that we are real. And the same goes here. That is deception. Suppose you have the old time lying in politics, you know, in the last century, the diplomats. Now, how is that? The diplomat goes and he knows very well, very precisely the truth which he has to hide, yeah? And what he is supposed to tell his opposite number, yeah, etc. That is a very small circle that cannot overwhelm him. You see? That's a very small circle of people in which lying is being done. That is, the masses don't enter. The moment everybody begins to say the same sentence, then he has forgotten the truth which he originally knew where to hide. And when this happens, when you no longer know the truth behind your own lies, then it's like wobbling, you know. It's as though the floor is no longer secure, you know. The CIA reports were absolutely close to facts, and the analysis was from on a minimum. Still, it was there, but on a minimum. They immediately took that as one more factor in their calculation. And by doing this through the pseudo-mathematical language, they deprived it of its impact on themselves, you know. They didn't no longer, if you finally have on your paper only certain equations in which you try to figure out the percentages, yeah, your imagination is no longer there. You know? That is, they live from the beginning in a defactualized world.
Could I ask a question about that? most moral theorists have thought that deliberate falsehoods, deliberate lies are somehow immoral, evil. Do you take this, I take it that you want to call this deliberate falsehood until they begin to believe it, but is the beginning of this process just another addition to the immorality of saturation bombing and free fire zones, or is it something more fundamental?
It's more fundamental, it's different. At least, this whole moral question about what is worse, actually is this gentleman here said, if the liar is convinced that he tells the truth, he becomes the truthful, and therefore better. And this, of course, is the usual moral conviction. I believe that what you would call the cold-blooded liar, who is still capable to know and remember that he is lying, is, in my account, of a higher moral stature than you are by far. Now, I have very little in literature. I have very much in personal experience. I have very little in literature to go on this firm conviction. But still, there's one thing. There is, I think, in the Brother Karamazov, yeah, there is a discussion, you know, the father of the Brother Karamazov, Misha, was a terrible liar and anyhow, by no means a very nice character. And he comes to the Starets and he asks the Starets, what must I do to gain eternal life, yeah? Something like this. And the Starets says, never lie to yourself. The Starets doesn't tell this old liar never lie. He knows he's going out and telling another lie in 5 minutes. But never lie to yourself. This is really a boundary which you, if the moment you start lying to yourself, that is a moment when rottenness begins. Not before. No, not really, because I would have to open this whole business and it would be another lecture, you know, at least. But I can say this is, all these things rely to an astounding degree on experiments with animals, you know. And it is true we can manipulate animals even there. Even among animals, there are certain animals which are not so easy to train, that is to manipulate. But to believe that these are paradigmata, yeah, for how people behave is of course fantastic. For a simple reason, if we don't want to go any further in the business, people can cheat, you know. And the simple ability to cheat is something which will defeat all manipulation. That is, all these are things which are calculated in a rational way. That's the reason why they are so plausible. The theory in itself is always consistent, or it doesn't apply. You know? That is the trouble. And I think the social sciences are about at the point where this is going to dawn on them. That is, that they are barking up the wrong tree. I mean, I don't mean that social science is to be thrown out the window. I mean only that there are certain theories, and one of them, see, since you cannot manipulate people actually, or it's very uncertain, therefore, this whole question of manipulability of people, of course, has acquired a very great importance, because you can teach the whole business only to true believers, you know. And so, I mean, with science this has nothing to do. But it has something to do with pseudoscience, and it has something to do this notion that each time a certain field of research has acquired a jargon of its own, that this means already that the science is, of course, also a very doubtful statement, and a statement on which many science rest. I think that this is almost on the way out, but I'm not sure. But one thing is sure, these people, some of whom I know and met after they had read my paper, so they knew what I thought about them, was quite interesting. These people are really convinced of it. They think, for instance, to put it very bluntly, that if there were not a Thucydides who wrote about the Peloponnesian War, there wouldn't be any Peloponnesian War. Yeah. And so on and so forth. You know. All these things are, you know, if you don't recognize a fact, it's not a fact. Yeah.
Take one more question.
Look, I've been talking here about one thing only, and that is about decision-making in government. Since the enemy doesn't play any role there, he couldn't very well play any role in what I have to say. I could only say the enemy was ignored. As far as I myself am concerned, see, I have known the Indochinese long before you, not only because I'm older, but because in France they studied. And we all know them as students. And they are highly gifted, very cultivated, you know, and they're very nice people also. So I cannot say that Indochinese or Annamese culture interests me more than any other culture, by no means. But of course I'm interested. Because so far away. Because it's so far, in spite of television. My God. It's so far away, complete different language. Also complete different culture, very high culture, but completely different. It's very difficult, you know.
Downstairs in this building.
Yeah.